Hello. I'm sure that you are by now familiar with the concept of programmable machines and have had the exposure to the architecture of 8085A microprocessor. The organization of memory has already been explained to you in earlier lessons. Today, what I plan to do is the number system, the machine code, the assembly language, assembler, role of flags, the addressing modes, the timing diagram, and the elements of flowcharting. The number systems is the first which I'm going to tackle today. We are all quite familiar with the decimal number system. But do you know who provided the 10th digit of the decimal number system? It was an Indian. The contribution of the great scientist is the one which has permitted all the scientists to use the decimal number system. The microprocessors and the digital systems which we have do not work with the decimal number system and work with the binary number system. The basic difference between the decimal number system and the binary number system is this, that in case of decimal number systems, we have got 10 different levels available, and in case of binary, we have got only 2 levels available, which we designate as 0 and 1. This 0 and 1 is what we call as bit, which is equivalent to of one binary digit. The advantage of 0 and 1 has been exploited by the digital circuit and microprocessor to the extent that they improve the reliability of the system. Apart from that, the binary number systems have additional advantage that they can be correlated directly with the voltage as well as the current levels. Since we have to work with binary number systems and are tuned to the decimal number system, we have to know how to convert from decimal number system to binary number system and from binary number system to decimal number system. This I'll try to explain to you with the help of an example. Let me first take an example of converting a decimal number system, which is 14, to a binary number system. The conversion is carried out by repeated division of the number by 2 and recording the remainders. For example, when I take the number 14, that is this, and I divide it by 2, I get 7 as the whole number with the remainder as 0. Then this 7 is to be divided by 2. The whole number which we get is 3 and the remainder is 1. Then this 3 is to be divided by 2. The result is 1 as the whole number and the remainder is 1. Then the remaining 1 which we had got here has to be once again divided by 2. The whole number we get is 0, and once again the remainder is 1. Once we have got these remainders, that is 0, 1, 1 and 1, we bring them down here and put them into a bracket and show it as 2, which indicates that 1110 is the binary equivalent of the hexadecimal number 14. Similarly, we can convert a binary number which is available to us, that is 1110, which is equivalent of 14 in decimal, by multiplication of each of these digits by a number which is 2 raised to the power n minus 1, where n is the position of the digit. So let's take this example, that is 1110. So the first one which we are taking has the fourth bit position, so that is why we say 1 into 4 minus 1. Then we have the second digit, that is 1 here, which is the third bit position, so we are saying 1 into 2 raised to the power 3 minus 1. Then we take the next bit, which is once again 1. So we say here 1 into 2 raised to the power 2 minus 1. And the last digit we have got is 0, which we have here as 0. This is to be multiplied by 2 raised to the power 1 minus 1. Now, 2 raised to the power 3 is 8. That is, 1 into 8 is 8. Then 2 raised to the power 2 is 4. 1 into 4 is 4. Then 2 raised to the power 1 is 2. 1 into 2 gives us 2. 2 raised to the power 0 is 0, is 1, multiplied by 0 gives us 0. So the sum of these, that is 8, 4, and 2, gives us 14, and the result is 14 to the base 10. So 14 to the base 10 is the equivalent of 1110 in binary. So this is how we are able to convert a binary number to the decimal number, and earlier we have already seen the conversion of a decimal number to binary number. 14 in decimal required 4 binary digits. On the other hand, if we have a larger decimal number, it will still require large number of binary digits. For example, if we have 255 to the base 10 here, this will require 8 binary digits. And as the number in decimal grows further, the number of binary digits required increases significantly. And at times it becomes very difficult to comprehend and write these binary digits. So accordingly, a convenient technique has been found to group the binary digits which we have got here in a combination of 4, which we call as the hexadecimal number. Now, hexadecimal number has got 16 different levels, starting from 0 and going up to F. What I have done here is, I have drawn a table in which I am showing you the representation of binary and its equivalent hexadecimal number. The first combination we have is 000, which is 0 in hexadecimal number. For that matter, from 0 to 9, the numbers which are available are same as in the decimal number system. So 9 in hexadecimal is equal to 101 in binary number system. 1010 in binary is represented as A. Since we have to represent the hexadecimal number using a single digit, we cannot write 10, which is available in decimal, so we represent it by 8. The next number is 1011, which is represented by B. 1100 in binary is represented by C. 1101 is represented by D. 1110 in binary is represented by E. And 1111 in binary is represented by F. So in all, using 4 binary digits, we had 16 combinations available, and the same combinations are represented by 16 different levels in hexadecimal number system. Now let us try to convert a binary number which is available to us into the hexadecimal number system. Let us take 1010, 1100, 1110, and 1111. The first 4 bits which we have are 1010. Corresponding to these 4 bits, we can look up from here and see that the equivalent of 1010 in binary is A in hexadecimal. So accordingly, we can replace 1010 by A here. Then the next we have is 1100, which we can look from here is having an equivalent which is C here. So accordingly, 1100 has been replaced by C here. Then the next combination of 4 binary digits we have is 1110. That is here. And corresponding to that, the hexadecimal number is E, and accordingly, it has been replaced here. The last combination we have here is 1111. That is equivalent to F in the hexadecimal number system. So the total number we have is ACEF in hexadecimal number. Now, in order to show that this is an hexadecimal number, we write base 16. In case we do not want to write base 16, we can represent it as ACEF followed by H. This H, which we have got here, indicates that the number we are writing is an hexadecimal number system. Now, once we have got this kind of a combination available, it is easier for us to replace the binary numbers with the help of the hexadecimal number system. And the advantage we get is the lesser number of digits required to represent it. So once we have got the bits available to us, we can have different codes. So this particular technique, that is conversion of binary to hex, is basically converting binary to a code. We have got various codes available. One of them is BCD, that is binary coded decimal number system. In binary coded decimal number system, what we have done is, out of the 16 possible combinations available, using 4 binary digits, the first 10 have been used, and the remaining 6 have not been used. Similarly, we have got other codes available. They could be ASCII, which stands for American Standard Code for Information Interchange. We have got other codes available like EBDIC and GRAY, etc. So using these codes, we can represent any combination of numerals, alphanumeric characters, or any other controlled characters as are required by the microprocessor or any other device. Let us see one of the codes, that is the machine code. The microprocessor is able to accomplish many things, but it requires a combination of bits. The combination of bits, as far as performance of the microprocessor is concerned, is what we call as the machine code. In order to achieve any result using a microprocessor, we'll need to write a sequence of instructions which need to be carried out. The problem here arises that each instruction which we have has got number of bits available. And remembering these bits or the pattern of bits for a user is very difficult. So what has been done is this, that we have associated certain mnemonics with the combination of the codes, that is the bits. Let us see here. For example, we want a particular action to be carried out, which can be represented by 0111100. The action which is carried out by this is copy the contents of register B to register A. Now, we know that this combination of binary digits will perform a particular function. But remembering such combinations or such like combinations is very difficult for anybody. So what has been done is a mnemonic has been associated with it. Now the mnemonic is something which indicates the action which is desired to be carried out using the instruction. Now here we have got move A comma B. This move A comma B is what is required to be done. That is, copy the contents of register B to A. We can take another example. Let us say our objective is to add the contents of register B to that of the accumulator. For this, the code available to us is 1000 followed by 40. Now, we may remember maybe 1 or 2 or maybe 10 or 20 combinations of binary digits. But again, I repeat, it is difficult to remember. So once again, we come to a situation where we associate a code which we call as mnemonic, and we say it is add. The moment we say add B, it automatically indicates to us that we want to add the contents of register B to that of accumulator. Similarly, we have got other combinations, 0111, 0110, and which means stop the execution of program. The mnemonic for this is halt. Similarly, when we have 1100011, which means branch out to the specified address, for that we have got a mnemonic called jump. Now, writing opcode in binary is once again difficult. So, what we do is, we replace this binary code by, once again, what we had discussed earlier, that is a hex code. So, this code, that is 0111000, is replaced by 78. Similarly, 10000 here, 0000 is replaced by 80, and so on and so forth. Now, 8085A microprocessor can have up to 256 possible combinations of binary digits for the simple reason that it's an 8-bit microprocessor. So, 2 raised to the power 8 gives us 256 possible combinations. Out of these 256 possible combinations, what has been done in case of 8085A microprocessor is 74 mnemonics have been associated with them. All 256 have not been used. So out of the 256, 74 mnemonics have been given, thereby correlating the code with the mnemonic. Now a programmer or the user of the microprocessor would normally write a program using these mnemonics. Once a program has been written, it is easy to comprehend. But in order to execute the program, once again, it is ultimately required that we should be able to replace the mnemonic by the opcode. Whether we write the opcode in hex or in binary, it is immaterial. Yet it is required that we have to convert the mnemonic into the opcode. It is certainly a cumbersome procedure. Once you write a program using mnemonics, then using a table, you try to convert the mnemonics into the opcode and then write the program in a microprocessor. To overcome this difficulty and relieve the user or the programmer from this arduous job, what has been done is that a software has been provided, which is what we call as the assembler. Now, assembler is a program which accepts as input a set of instructions consisting of mnemonics and generates a series of instructions in the form of opcode. Now, what is the result? The result is this: the user who had written the program using mnemonics has got the program which is in opcode, and he has been relieved from the responsibility of converting the program using a table into the opcode. Now, the combination, the number of mnemonics, as I've already told you, in case of 8085 is 74. The set of such mnemonics is what we call as the assembly. At this stage, we are aware of the machine code, that is, what is the machine code, the assembly language, and assembler. Before I proceed further, I would like to discuss now the formats which are there for writing the instructions that form the part of assembly language. Instructions are commands that are issued to the microprocessor for carrying out various actions. Each instruction consists of two parts. First is what we call as the opcode, and second is what we call as the operand. Opcode specifies the action to be carried out by the instruction, and operand is the one on which the action is to be carried out. The operand could be 8-bit data or 16-bit data. It could be a memory location. It could be 8-bit or 16-bit address. In some of the instructions, the operand is implicit also. In fact, there are three different types of categories in which the instructions are divided. They are what we call as 1-byte instruction, 2-byte instruction, and 3-byte instruction. Now, let us look at 1-byte instruction first. Let us say that we have the instruction move C, A. The action which is going to be carried out by this is copy the contents of accumulator to register C. The binary code for this is 0100 followed by 1111, and its hex code is 4FH. This H indicates that the code which we are using is in hexadecimal fashion. Next instruction we can take is add B, which means add the contents of register B to that of the accumulator. Once again, the binary code has been specified as 1000000, and its hexadecimal equivalent is 80H. Then we have CMA. The action of that is complement each bit of accumulator. The binary code for the same is 0010-1111, and hex code of the same is 2FH. Now, if you look at these three examples which are written here, you can see here, in the first case, there are two operands which have been specified. In the second case, only one operand has been specified. In the third case, no operand has been specified. Which means what? In this case, the operand is implicit. That means automatically this instruction assumes that the operand is accumulator. Whereas in this case, we have specified only one operand. The second operand is implicit. In this case, both the operands have been specified. Each one of these three instructions would require 1 byte in memory for the purpose of storage. Let us look at 2-byte instructions now. It has got 2 bytes. First byte is corresponding to the opcode, and second byte is corresponding to the operand. This particular instruction, that is MVI A, comma data, means that load an 8-bit data byte in the accumulator. The opcode for this is 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, and 0. This is corresponding to the first byte. And the second byte is corresponding to the data for which I have written here DDDD to indicate that it's the data. Corresponding to the opcode, the hexadecimal equivalent is 3E, and corresponding to the data has been written here, which can be replaced by the actual data in the hexadecimal fashion. So you can see here the first byte in a 2-byte instruction would always correspond to the opcode, and the second byte in the 2-byte instruction will always correspond to the data in the instruction. The third type of the format which we have is the 3-byte instruction. In case of 3-byte instruction, the first byte once again corresponds to the opcode. In this case, we are using the opcode for jump. This means transfer the program sequence to the memory location. In this case, the memory location we have specified here is 8085. The first byte is corresponding to the opcode, that is 11000011. The hexadecimal equivalent for the same is C3H. Then we have the 16-bit address which needs to be specified here. One important thing to be remembered here is that the lower byte of the address is to be written in the second byte, and the upper byte of the address is to be written in the third byte. So corresponding to the lower byte, that is 85, we have got 10000100. The hexadecimal equivalent for the same is 85, and for 80, the binary equivalent is 1000 and 0000, which I have written here as 80H. So the first byte would always correspond to the opcode, second would correspond to the lower address, and the third would correspond to the upper byte of the address. Now, how the internal registers, or for that matter, the memory, is taken care of in the opcode is to be decided using the format for the opcode. So let's try to go to the format for the opcode now. In order to understand the operation code, it is important for us to understand how the instructions are built in the microprocessor. All operation codes, the registers and the flags, have been built in the microprocessor, and each one of them is identified using a particular code. We are more interested at the moment in the registers. So let us look at the codes which are required for representing the register. We have got 7 general purpose registers available to us, that is B, C, D, E, H, L, and A. In order to represent and distinguish 7 different registers, we require at least 3 bits. So accordingly, 3 bits have been used. Since we have one spare code available, that is used to represent the memory location. For register B, we have got the code as 000. For C, we have got 001. For D, we have got 010. For E, we have got 011. For H, it is 100. For L, it is 101. For A, we have got 111. And for memory-related operation, we have got 110. Similarly, when we want to interact with the register pairs, we come across 3 register pairs which are normally talked about, that is BC, DE, and HL. Since we have got 3 of them available, we require at least 2 bits to represent them, and 2 bits can distinguish 4 different quantities, so we have another special register, that is SC, being brought in. In order to represent BC, the code available to us is 00. For DE, we have the code as 01. For HL, the code available to us is 10. And for SP, the code is 11. At this stage, with this knowledge of the codes for registers as well as register pairs, let us see how we can construct the opcodes. Let us take a 1-byte opcode first. Let us say the function we are looking forward to is to rotate each bit of the accumulator to the left by 1 position. The opcode for this is 0000111. Since we have to refer to the accumulator, we have to have the code for the accumulator, which is 111, and as was defined earlier. So this code, that is 07, automatically indicates to the microprocessor when it is implementing it that it has to interact with the accumulator, that is register A, and at the same time it has to rotate the contents of accumulator left by 1 bit. Let us take another example now. Let us say that we want to add the contents of register to the accumulator. Now this register could be any register which we had talked about earlier. The code for carrying out the addition is 10000. We want the contents of a particular register, let us take the register B, to be added. Where the contents of this are to be added, that is implicit here, that is the register A. The code for register B is 000, and the code for A is implicit. If we jot down these codes which we have written here, then the binary instruction which we get is 10000, which is the code for add, and 000, which is the code for register B. The hexadecimal equivalent of the same is 80H. In case we want to write down the same thing, we can put it in this fashion, that is, add B, where add is the mnemonic and B is the operand, or we can say add is the opcode. The code for the same in hexadecimal form would be 80H. Let's take another example now to understand the things in a better fashion. In this particular example, what we want to do is to move or copy the contents of a register which we say as source register to a register which we call as the destination register. Normally the source register is designated as RS and the destination register is designated as RD. The code for move is 01. As we had seen earlier, the codes for register C and A are 001 and 111 respectively. If we copy these things in one line, what we get is 01001111 in binary fashion. Its hexadecimal equivalent, which is available to us now, is 4FH. Same thing we can write in another fashion, and we can say move C, A, for which the code available to us is 4FH. In this thing with what we have written here, the move corresponds to the opcode, C and A correspond to the operand. So far we have seen three different types of instructions, that is 1 byte instruction, 2 byte instruction, and 3 byte instruction. These are the different types available to us. Obviously, my requirement as a programmer would be to use 1 byte instructions as far as possible, for the simple reason that they would require lesser amount of memory for storage. And since only 1 byte is being stored, the interaction with the memory would be lesser, thereby reducing the time required for interaction. Although this is what we want, yet it will not always be possible, for the simple reason that everything cannot be encoded in 1 byte instruction format. So accordingly, we have got 2 byte and 3 byte instruction formats available. The use and the choice of 1 byte or 2 byte or 3 byte instruction would depend upon the situation and the requirement, and also on the basis of the fact that what is the time required, or the what is the time frame within which one particular action is required to be carried out. At this stage, the efficiency of these instructions cannot be compared, which we'll do at a later stage. But before talking about that, we should be able to appreciate the role of flags, which are very important as far as the branching is concerned. So in the second part of this particular lesson, we will cover the timing diagram, the role of flags, the addressing modes, and the basics of flowcharting.